Hello, welcome back to another episode of the Virtual Ninja Show. My name is Heike, and today I have Leor with me. Leor, please introduce yourself.
Hi, Heike. I'm Leor. I'm based in Israel. I'm a senior product manager at Microsoft's Defender for Cloud Apps, and I'm in charge or involved with the connectors, which I'm very excited to talk about today.
I was just about to say that's our topic, connectors. But before we actually dive right into, explain a little bit what connectors are.
Sure, Heike. So basically, when we have Defender for Cloud Apps, we can do our magic when we're connected to applications. In other words, we typically have our first-party applications, the Microsoft suite, which, of course, is natural to us to be able to protect and to monitor. But we also have a suite of over 25 connectors, which we call connectors, which are other applications we can connect to. And we have a bunch of goodies like Salesforce, Google, ServiceNow, that we can protect as well.
So when you say we have these first-party connectors and we have connectors to other applications, why do we need connectors? What are they used for? What can Defender for Cloud Apps do with connectors or don't without them?
Sure. So that's a great question. So the way it works is that in order for us to protect an application, we need to be able to connect to it and get the events from that application. So for example, you have users and like Heike, for example, and we see Heike's logging in from certain areas with certain characteristics. We need to get those events. And when we have those events, we are then able to monitor and do our magic and figure out what's a threat, what's a cyber risk.
So that means when we have first-party or third-party connectors, only then Defender for Cloud Apps is able to give you certain user activities that are happening with that application?
Yeah, so that's a great starting point, because actually we don't just protect for users, we also protect for some applications. Some of our connectors are able to protect app interactions. For example, has someone consented another application with OAuth, and we can detect that on some of our connectors. Also, what we have is SSPM, which is SaaS Security Posture Management, and that's really cool because what that does is it allows us to see before an attack has happened, pre-breach, what are the configurations that are required for these applications to stop an attack before it actually happens?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, also making sure the app is communicating securely.
So it's communicating to us securely, yes, but we're checking that any configurations on the application, for example, someone hasn't enabled SSO or MFA. I mean, those are the most basic ones, but just conceptually, we can see that someone hasn't configured SSO or MFA for the organization. That's a risk because, of course, it means that someone could just enter with credentials, credential stuffing or something could work. The other one is, as I said, app to app is where literally someone can connect another application with OAuth consenting. And we have visibility in that in our first party and in some of our third party as well, which we're growing.
So first party, I would assume the connectors are pretty much simple, like they're there. Do you still need to toggle them on somehow, or is this automatically turned on?
So it's a great question. When you enable Defender for Cloud Apps, you do need to consent to give that flow of data. And the same goes with third party, but with first party, which is the Microsoft suite, of course, it's just one button and we do all the magic in the background. When it's the third party, it's a little bit more of a complex process. I'd love to show you one. In fact, if we can dive into one.
Yes, I would love that because I assume everyone out there is able to toggle something, but you know, these connectors that you have to set up, they might be a little bit more complicated, some not. So, but yeah, let's have a look. Which one are we going to look at?
So the one I wanted to show you today is ServiceNow, because that's one of the easier ones to connect. It's one of the ones that just show the power of how easy it is to connect. And I'll dive into a little one that's maybe a little more complex. Okay, so Heike, here we are. As I said, we're in ServiceNow. So we're in the actual ServiceNow portal. What we're doing is we're setting up the OAuth application. Like I mentioned, we protect against OAuth. We need that consent, actually, to be able to connect. So here we create an external OAuth application, one to connect to external clients. I'm clicking on it now and it should load. And what we see here is the screen to set up in ServiceNow. Now you'll notice I'm talking about ServiceNow. This isn't actually in our portal. I give it a name, Cloud App Security. And now what I do is I need to save the data that it's going to create. For example, the client ID. Let me just paste that on the side here. Then we've got to change the token lifespan and the refresh token lifespan. This is how often you need to refresh the token. And now, as I said, I've got to copy the client secret, which is not something you share with people, and the client ID. And I'm pasting that on the side now for use in the portal in Defender for Cloud Apps. So we're basically almost done. Now we're in Defender for Cloud Apps. I go to connect an app. I choose ServiceNow. I enter an instance name. So this is for field training. So I'm going to type it, field training. Now it's very easy to connect. Give it a bit of time. I want the security recommendations to be enabled here. And this is effectively what we're talking about. To like allow the security recommendations in, I want to connect with the OAuth token. I put my username in, my password, and the instance URL, which in this instance, I've just used a dev instance.
That URL is what URL?
It's all described in our documentation. It's the URL of the dev instance you're using. So this was just a random dev instance I created for this demo. And I put the client ID and our client secret, which of course will be blanked out. And you click next and then validating and then should have magic.
Okay, so that was basically really simple. So you first have to grab some details and set something up in the third-party application. But then here you went through, so you entered some credentials. Are those the credentials to sign into that third-party connector?
Exactly. So that's exactly it. We're trying to say, give us permission so that we can read the events that we want to read from the third-party application. And the idea is that with this connection that we create, the secure connection that we create, we can ingest the events we need. We ingest the users, the events, the configurations, a whole bunch of good stuff that allows us to give the recommendations and protect against any risks that are in your environment, either before they happen or after they happen.
Okay, so Leor, that was, again, an easy one. So we talked about it could be a little bit more complicated. Why is something sometimes more complicated with these connectors? Because it's straightforward, kind of, right? So you get some details, connection details from the app, you enter them on the other side, and then handshake, yoo-hoo. So what is the challenge with some of the other third-party connectors?
So some of the other third-party connectors, it's not that the connection is difficult. It's that getting to the little snippets that we need is a little more complicated in their product because they don't necessarily know that we exist in the way that we're trying to exist. We're trying to read their security data, which is totally normal and 100% like in the terms of use, but just the developers on there and didn't think, oh, let me cater for Microsoft in this respect. So you've got to dig a little deeper. And I'd love to actually show you that as well in the Google one as an example.
That would be great. Yes, let's have a look at something complicated.
So here you see the way to connect Google, and you see it's Google Workspace. And what we're trying to do is if you scroll down and you look here, this is just telling us the threats and the SaaS security posture management, all the goodness that I told you about. And then we're going to get to the actual connection here, which is connect Google Workspace to Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps. If you scroll down, you can see you've got to configure Google Workspace, you've got to give it a project name, you've got to choose the project number. It's a bunch of steps there. In fact, I think it's like 10 or 11 steps. And on the Google side, here we got to number 9, 10, 11 steps. Then you get to configure Defender for Cloud Apps, and it's very short. It's the exact same story that we had before. The only difference is that this is with Google, which requires the instance on Google side to give us the data available for Microsoft Defender for Cloud Apps to work. It's a very similar flow.
Okay. But I see that there is a lot of other connectors in the navigation. So for all the connectors that we have, there is a documentation and customers can find out how they get to that configuration snippets that they need.
Yes, exactly. And also in the portal, when you're in the portal, there's a link to the documentation as well. So you don't have to necessarily know the link or search for it on Bing. You can also, in the portal, we direct to the documentation as well.
Okay. So, and can you add as many connectors as you want? Or is there like, nope, you can only have 5?
So that's a great question. So basically what we do at the moment is we limit to 50 connectors of each type. So you could have 50 Okta, 50 OneLogin, 50 Salesforce, et cetera. And this can also be overridden. So I don't see many instances where that happens, but we have got cases where we have overridden that.
Okay. So do customers have so many workspaces in Okta, in Google or somewhere? What is a workspace? Sorry.
It's very good. It's an instance. We call it an instance. And what that is effectively where someone has, I'll use Google as an example, right? You have Google for your big organization, Leor organization, and Leor goes and buys another organization, a smaller organization, and they use Google as well, but they haven't yet integrated fully. So you need to create an instance for their organization and for the larger organization. And that organization then will have 2 instances. And it could also be one last idea is that it could also be for different governance requirements that you have separate residency of your data, and you need to connect both of them to Defender for Cloud Apps.
So also what I would interpret for Microsoft as tenants, right? So we have the same with customers acquiring a different another company, and then they have already an office tenant or something that they need correct. To either include correct. Or merge. Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's correct.
And do we now get more data into Defender for Cloud Apps, and does this cost something to add these connectors?
So as part of the Defender for Cloud Apps license, whatever license you have, E5 or a standalone, however it works with your specific license, these are all included. We charge on a usage basis, not a consumption basis. So maybe that sounds confusing, but basically you have the license, you can connect your connectors. The downstream effect of where you flow that data may be to Sentinel, which is a consumption-based product, mm-hmm. and you need to investigate how you get that into Sentinel to make sure that you are managing your costs. But assuming that you just enable it on Defender for Cloud Apps to get your alerts and incidents in the portal, in the Defender portal, so then there's no additional cost.
Mm-hmm. So also earlier, you know, we talked about the username and the password. So what are the permissions needed to actually get access to that third-party application?
So that's a great question. We have a bunch of requirements for different connectors are slightly different, what we call connectors for the applications. So it varies. In general, they're quite high. They're admin permissions because we need to read a lot of data. But we are working on reducing that because we're familiar with the fact that it needs to be least privilege and that for certain ones, we only need read-only. For some, we don't need admin permissions. And certainly for posture, where we're just, as I discussed earlier, where we're trying to just pre-breach, stop an attack, we don't necessarily need those permissions. So we're constantly working on reducing those permissions, making sure that the usage of correct permissions is aligned with industry standards.
Mm-hmm. So you, because you don't write anything there, right? So you basically read, or is there also something that you add, configure?
So yes, we only read, we don't write. And in fact, what we do for our recommendations is we recommend what to do in the portal that's relevant. So for example, if in ServiceNow you haven't enabled SSO or MFA, as I mentioned earlier, so then we recommend where to go into the portal and make those amendments to make sure that your product is fully secured. So we don't write. We only have read access in general.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then are you working with those third-party companies to modify or improve the connectors? Or is this something that Microsoft has to work on it on its own?
So we have both. We have some organizations with whom we have a partnership. And with those organizations, we work actively together to improve the connector with them. And with the others, the large organizations who don't necessarily have a relationship with us, we constantly on top of their documentation, on their mailing lists, in their forums to see how we can improve. Any new features that come out, we're on top of it. And we make sure to adhere to that. I'll give you an example. ServiceNow are releasing a new version called Yokohama. We know about it. We're on top of it. We're updating our application so that you don't have to worry about it.
Okay. So I would assume it doesn't cost anything extra, right? It gives you a lot of additional value. So everybody out there who uses Defender for Cloud Apps, go turn on the connectors. Do you, Leor, have some last recommendations or something you hear from customers, something you would like to share with our audience?
Sure. I think that the main thing is just to know that we're consistently working on these to improve them, reduce the access required, improve the depth of our connectors and expanding the breadth by introducing new connectors. So I'd love to hear from people in the comments. If there's any connectors that are, or anything we can do to improve on them, that's certainly, it's a big focus of ours. And it's something I'm working on actively to make sure that the experience is seamless. It's accurate and provides customer value. At the end of the day, that's our main driver.
So I assume, you know, there's like so many different connectors that we saw, which means those are usually the top notch connectors, the most wanted one that our customers are asking for. But if someone needs a connector for an app that we haven't considered yet, so what's the best way for them to maybe request one or get us the idea of it?
So the best way to do it actually is in the portal. We have a set up a button on the connector. You click connect a new application and you scroll down to the bottom and there's request another application or add an application that isn't there. And that comes to us. So we'll assess it. We'll look at the customer value we can provide, the demand and the data behind that to see if it warrants the development of a new connector or a new application. And we look at that actively, and it's something we monitor. So make sure to submit via that.
And as you are the owner, it will land at your desk. So this is the way to reach you. I hear this.
Exactly. A roundabout way, but yes, will come to me.
Yes. Okay. So it doesn't cost anything. It just gives you tons of extra value. So everybody out there who is using Defender for Cloud Apps, turn on the connectors of the applications that your users are using. Any last words, recommendations, or anything from you, Leor?
I think you've hit the nail on the head. And the last thing is just to say that by connecting these applications, really there's no downside. Like from a Defender for Cloud Apps perspective, we give our ability to protect you is with you giving us the ability to protect you. You need to enable us to enable the protection.
Yeah. So thank you so much, Leor, for being my expert on today's episode. Thanks everyone out there for watching, and I hope I see you all soon again. Bye.